Yo, we're live! With the sequel! It's fucking Onimusha 2. God, you have no idea just how... Like, ever since finishing the first game, again, like, this past Wednesday, just anxiously waiting for the weekend so that I could finally just dive into this. Even starting a whole hour early on top of that. Just because I can. It's a Saturday. I have the time. This little video with the music playing is like, I'm pretty sure. Yo, hey guy. You're just watching like the pre-game trailer, I guess you'd call it. The one that's probably going to get me hit with a content ID when I upload this VOD to YouTube. But I don't give a shit. Like this... Like, this song's pretty pumping. How's your Saturday going, by the way? It's just thinking of, again, how it's like, you go from Onimusha 1, and then to this, and it's just like, the whole, like, these type of opening videos that just play when you sit on the title screen could not be any more different, really. And I think it makes sense as well, considering the... Particularly with the history of, like, this game as far as how it was developed. There is actually next to no overlap with the team that made the first Onimusha when it came to the sequel. They basically had two separate teams that were, like, pretty much working on these entries, like, on their own, because they understood that Onimusha was being designed from the outset as being, like, this big trilogy. So they had, like, the Onimusha 1 team, which, you know, which, like, had its own share of people working on it that clearly had experience working on, like, the Resident Evil games. Hence the various, like, structural similarities. While as here, we've got, like, you know, the same gameplay skeleton, but it's being used and contextualized by, like, a whole different team of developers to create something that is much more of, like, a pure adventure game, really. I mean, there's still action in it. It's not pure adventure to the point that it could be, like, a point-and-click or something like that, but it feels like... You get the sense that there is way more an idea of you having to, like, do a lot of, like, exploring the locations you go to as they come along. As well as a whole lot of other unique, complicated systems that only this game has. Like, that's the... Again, that's the beauty of, like, this entire trilogy. Like, it's not just, like, a simple, like, straightforward, safe iteration going from game to game. There's always, like, something different being put on top of the core gameplay. And yes, as expected, I have, like, a system file for this game that basically has everything unlocked. If I was crazy enough, I could try starting this on critical, but... Nah. No, like, there's skilled YouTube long plays that can give you, like, a better viewing experience of that than I could. So we're going to stick to normal. We're not going to turn on ultimate mode, which basically gives you the most powerful endgame sword and unlimited, like, resources for, like, projectiles and I think magic as well. Yeah. Basically, we're starting this game with the defaults, as intended. And now it's time to get into the real opening video.
In 1560, after this,
like, opening
Lord
narration.
Nobunaga Oda defeated Yoshimoto Imagawa in Okehazama.
Mm-hmm.
Soon after his victory, Nobunaga fell to a fatal arrow which pierced his throat.
Yep,
however,
just
Nobunaga
recapping,
far from
like, the whole plot
with
of Onimusha 1.
With the demons, he rose from the dead.
I recognize
the
all those jobbers.
Began their rampage, slaughtering innocent villagers. Then a young warrior, Samanosuke Akechi, stood up.
Yeah, Takeshi Kaneshiro. Demon King. He was pretty good.
The nightmare, however, did not end. A few years later, his strength restored, Nobunaga was set to conquer the entire country.
And become literal Satan. Because that's what most Japanese media can only seem to portray him as. In like the most basic, uninteresting way possible. Hey, Yusaku Matsuda. That dude was already dead by the time that they made this game. So they only got his likeness by striking a deal with the estate. Which, that could only be a massive fucking pain to deal with. To the point where I understand, even if it's annoying, that they did not remaster any of the Onimusha games past the first one. It's probably a lot easier to, like, work with Takeshi Kaneshiro since, you know, he's still alive. Oh yeah, that's right, Keita Amamiya. Like, oh man. After watching Mechanical Violator Hakaider, several weeks ago, and learning that he was the dude that created Garo, like the Tokusatsu series, it suddenly makes a whole lot more sense looking at some of like the demon designs in this game that, yeah, no wonder they got him on board for this. They look exactly like the sort of things that could have existed as Tokusatsu monster designs in any of his works. But yeah, as I was about to say, I completely missed like the name of it when they showed it, but the composer for this is, as you'd expect, different from the one that they had last time. You know, the composer who was actually a hack fraud that had someone ghostwrite for him while he pretended to be deaf. But yeah, it's like Onimusha 1's opening with like the whole, with like that starting battle with Nobunaga's forces, you know, and like Samanosuke watching from afar, like that was already cool. That was like already like good CGI by like 2001 standards. This, as you'd expect for like mid to late 2002, big step up, but also just how much longer it goes for and what it's showing is like, I think it does a good job of reflecting the difference in ambition that this game has compared to the first. Particularly with, like, this montage right here, as we get a good look at our supporting cast. There's AK. AK, or however you say it, yeah. This fat, drunk spearman. The crazy, like, stage play looking like aesthetic they got going on. Yo, Kotaro Fuma! Now that I think about it, the only other opening or like video of this type I could think of, especially from Capcom, was I think it was like the opening video for Street Fighter V Arcade Edition. Magoichi Saiga. Acting all cool with his flintlock and matchlock pistols. But yeah, it's like Street Fighter V, when people who stuck with it could claim that it finally got good with Arcade Edition, like it had a similar opening with this where it was highlighting like the new characters that were part of that current season. And like, it's a cool vibe. Oh yeah, there's our female side character of the game, Oyu. And of course, our protagonist, Jubei Yagyu, who obviously looks nothing like the initial version that they had when you saw the little teaser video that you unlocked at the end of Onimusha 1. You know, he had like a, you know, his hair was more tied back and he had an eye patch. This, obviously, once they finally got the likeness, they just made him look more like the dude back in his prime, you know, when he was alive.
A new warrior, Jubei Yagyu, heard about a demon attack on his hometown, Yagyu Village. Fearing the ominous presentiment in his heart, he desperately raced back home.
Now get ready. Like, again, to reiterate for context, this game came out in August of 2002, literally weeks. It is weeks away now, I shit you not, from being a full 20 years old. This came out the same year as Resident Evil Remake and RE0 on the GameCube. And these pre-rendered backgrounds are, like, so up there. This was, like, this is the last we ever saw of, like, these kind of backgrounds as part of the design in any game, let alone Capcom. And goddammit, they just nailed it. They hit it right out of the park. Like, you know they're proud when they're able to open on a shot of not just, like, a pre-rendered background of a destroyed village, but a pre-rendered background with actual rain effects and lightning.
Jubei.
And it's like,
Jubei.
Obviously, there's only so much I can do to, like, convey how it looks over the stream, but it's like, oh, you have no idea how fucking good this looks until you, like, witness this on, like, a CRT over component. Like, it is stellar. And no one wanted to deal with, like, these pre-rendered backgrounds anymore because it meant, in order to smoothly control your character through it, it meant having tank controls. And people just got tired of, like, tank controls or just couldn't be bothered to simply adjust to how that sort of thing works. Oh well, it is what it is. Point is, more indie games that have this kind of setup, please. Thank you. Oh yeah, we're back with the English voice acting, and it's just as bad, if not worse, than it was in the last game. Jubei's voice actor, especially in English, is like, there's a whole lot of lines that come from him his delivery is so strained, it makes it sound like he's reading his lines while trying to take a shit. It's the only way I could describe it. Even though I'm pretty sure the intent was to try and, like, mimic the tone and inflection of, like, the Japanese voice actor. Because I did watch some of the game, like, with the Japanese version for comparison. And yeah, the tone is, yeah, it's again that misguided voice direction of trying to make the other language actors still try and sound like their original Japanese counterparts. Anyway, let's get some E-Sense. Got two. One thing that's gonna be very clear as we start coming across more and more enemies. Hold on. I'm trying to... Come on. I'm trying to get something. Yeah! Isen chaining. Like the emphasis and priority of Isen as, like, a key, like, gameplay mechanic of the Onimusha games, like, became such a bigger deal when it got to Onimusha 2. Like, in the first game, it was a nice thing to have if you could afford it, but it was, as you'd expect, very difficult to pull off naturally, you know? Only really on, like, the fodder enemies, I would argue. If you got it on, like, the big undead samurai or bull demons or anything like that, it was more like you got it out of luck. And granted, for these red samurai dudes, it's still very difficult to pull off. But But like just the general timing on both regular Isen and block Isen is like it is significantly more lax. I would argue that it's actually the easiest in this game than it is in any of the other Onimusha games. So if you kind of want to get yourself a taste of what it's like playing a game where all you do is just kill enemies with critical hits, this is probably a better game to get started on that than something like Onimusha 3. Because it's still derived from like what this game introduced with like its expanded Isen mechanics. But I think because of like the even more increased action focus, like it's marginally more difficult in 3. But God, it is immensely satisfying. They knew that Isen was a cool idea. And like just the devs of this team saw what the Onimusha 1 team had started with, and we were like, oh yeah. Oh yeah, we could do something more with this. And that's on top of the other gameplay mechanics this game has, which retroactively got added into Onimusha 1 via the Xbox port. Like, this game introduces both the Onimusha mode and the charge attacks.
A demon woman.
Where you, like, charge up a sword, like your sword, so that it has different, it has increased power, but it doesn't count as a magic attack.
What?
Kill him, for he is the real demon.
A demon? What are you talking about?
defeat the demon, Jubei. Your hand has the power to absorb the souls of demons. Use this power to defeat Nobunaga.
So there we go. We don't need an Oni Gauntlet. We can just directly steal souls.
5 sacred orbs were created to protect humans from the demons. Charity. Faith, honesty, respect, and strength. Gather all the orbs and defeat Nobunaga.
It's a very epic action adventure concept. Collect these key items to defeat the big evil.
Then you may begin your quest in the gold mine in Imasho.
Yep, we got our quest.
You can do it, my son.
Bye. I will not elaborate any further. There we go. We got our first orb. And explaining for us how to do, like, the soul absorption, magic attacks, charged attack, as it shows here, after you've equipped the magic weapon, tightly holding the R1 button, press square to perform a charged attack. So, one thing that's important to emphasize. In Genma Onimusha, when they added charged attacks, it was you literally held the attack button, and it would charge up to 3 different levels. Here, because this is a PS2 game, further proving once again that the DualShock 2 is the greatest video game controller of all time, making use of the game's analog pressure-sensitive buttons, like holding R1 extra tight is what causes your sword to charge up. If you just hold it like the bare minimum, it doesn't charge it at all. So yeah, it's not just Hideo Kojima games or Gran Turismo that use it, or the Bouncer. This game does it as well. Anyway. Yeah. Little soul cash for a whole lot of money. Is there anyone else? And there's a purple orb, which contributes to those five slots that once all five are filled, we automatically go into Onimusha mode. And that's actually one thing I generally find kind of annoying about that particular mode. As much as I like it, it's like, A, the chances of those purple orbs dropping is insanely low. And B, when you get the fifth one, it just automatically pops that mode anyway. You don't even get like a manual button to activate it, which I think that was fixed. I think they added a button to manually activate it when you got to Onimusha 3. Which I would hope they did, because that's literally... Because that's basically your devil trigger. Like, why wouldn't you want to have, like, full manual control over when and where you activate it? Come on, what you got? Ah, fuck. God, it is still so, like, liberating. As much as I think I still like Genma Onimusha the most, like, the thrill of getting E-Sens, like, regularly is so liberating once you get to this game. Because of just how absolutely easy it is. To the point where... I don't know, I almost worry that it could be described as being, like, so good as to be detrimental to the very design, at least in the context of, like, it being an action game. Anyway, hold on, let's get this. Oh yeah, we got trick puzzle boxes left. We got them back. Obviously a bit different now. Power jewel. Oh yeah, for the record, this is our house. We technically don't need to go here at this stage in the game, but it's nice to do it just for getting some, like, particular items out of the way. Like something that we can pick up. Because that's an important thing about playing through Onimusha 2, is that, like, there's obviously a critical path you can go on, but it's actually kind of ill-advised to just, like, brute force your way from, like, place to place. It pays to explore because there's a lot of items that are, like, not only a benefit to you as a player, but also stuff that qualifies as gifts. You know, like you see right here, we got objects and we got gifts. We've been collecting a lot of gifts. These are going to be important later on, believe me. All right. Let's just keep getting everything we need out of here. Yep. Yeah, that's your cue to, like, cut open an object. God, it just... ugh. Like, there's such a wonderful, like, sense of craft behind designing a game with pre-rendered backgrounds and having, like, actual 3D objects that manage to look like they belong and are not out of place. Like, it's the sort of thing where it's, like, that kind of issue definitely crops itself up, I think, if you're, like, playing, obviously, like, on an emulator where the resolution of the backgrounds clearly does not match the upscaled resolution of the 3D objects themselves. This, meanwhile, is just right, because this is a 480i game, you know? Like, the backgrounds are scaled down and compressed so that they work in, a space of, you know, within 640 by 480 pixels. So with that kind of resolution, they could obviously, like, account for the objects looking like, at that similar fidelity as well. And looking the best they can, because the because the whole background itself, even when parts of it are animated like a GIF, it doesn't take up nearly the amount of, like, memory and resources that just raw polygons would for an entire scene. Okay, I want to try and get this. There we go. Yeah, for whatever reason, when it comes to the Red Samurai dudes, I've definitely had an easier time of, like, killing them with a critical if it was a block critical, you know? Anyway, I think that's all I needed. Yeah, and I even got both pieces of the Four Guardians art. And I got the Power Jewel as well. Yeah, I'd say we are ready to go on our quest proper to Imasho Town. Now that we have, we got all our belongings from this destroyed, from this destroyed home of ours. Ah, damn it. Oh, well. Again, they make the Red Samurai dudes, like, their timing, by comparison. Yo, Arian! Yeah, I'm doing good. Thanks for stopping by, man. Glad you're here to see some Onimusha action. The freaking wall splat after I countered him. Oh, that was sick. But yeah, one thing that, like, you can tell, like, kind of gives... like even if you're against some enemies where, like, their Isen timing is extremely tight, like Onimusha 1 fodder enemy tight. Like, the nice thing is that because of how you can chain Isen moves together, it's like if you go out of your way to first counter the move of, like, a weak fodder enemy that has an extremely wide counter window, then you can just chain that over to the big enemy and kill them instantly. It works. Actually, just about to install Onimusha 3. Nice. Yeah, I'm... Ah, come on. Man, Onimusha 3, that is a wild, wild fucking game. I'm genuinely curious to see what I think about it now because of how it's like... I played through all, like, the games, like, in the trilogy, like, to the end, but Onimusha 3, I'm pretty sure I only ever played through once. Whereas I've done a couple playthroughs of Onimusha 2, I've done a lot of Onimusha 1 across both the PS2 original and Genno. But it's like, I remember there being, like, some cool things that I did like about 3. Even though I kind of lamented, like, the fact that they dropped the pre-rendered backgrounds on that just for, like, a more traditional, like fully 3D polygonal space. Which, I might possibly be remembering it worse than it actually is, because the way I... Hold on. There we go. I just wanted to get that out of the way. But it's like, I think about, like, the move away from pre-rendered backgrounds in Onimusha 3, like, I look at it, like, with the level of, like, fondness or respect that I did something like, okay, here's, like, a Capcom example that probably makes sense. You know how, like, when Code Veronica, like, on the Dreamcast, like, it, like, all of the backgrounds in that were no longer pre-rendered, they were actually, like, full 3D models. And despite being on more powerful hardware than the PS1, it looked, like, demonstrably worse and, like, lifeless in comparison to the environments you had in the first three games. My brain keeps telling me it's kind of like that with Onimusha 3, despite the fact that it is probably the best in terms of, like, the action game feel of the trilogy. I'm obviously not counting Dawn of Dreams in the equation just because I've not been able to get myself to go all the way through it to know.
I will get my revenge. You will pay for this. Nobunaga!
Mm-hmm.
In 1568, gold was discovered in the Valley of Imasho, which is situated between the Mino province of Oda, the North Omi province of Asai.
I genuinely want to know, like,
Asakura.
Who the voice of, like, this narrator is. Greed, because his inflection, for whatever reason, like, it gives me the sense that maybe English is not his primary language, and he is trying to enunciate English as clearly as he can, despite, like, having a different accent. Never played 1 and 2, but 3 and 4. Really? That's interesting.
He's dead!
What are you doing?
Wow. Life sucks with these peasants.
Hey, sweet thing. Don't you want to serve me a little sake?
So you think you're too good for me, huh? Let go!
So because I could get my chance on 1 and 2 and 3 was the only one released on PC. Oh, God. Oh, God, that is so right. I completely fucking forgot Onimusha 3 got a PC port. That was deep in the dark ages of, like, Capcom PC ports. That was before they got even somewhat respectable because of the fact that they started porting their games that were on MT Framework and it was a multi-platform engine to begin with. Like, oh god, I completely forgot about that. Anyway, here we are in our new location. We got, like, a whole lot of NPCs to talk to, some of who give us items. It's one of the Ubisoft ports. Right, yeah, Ubisoft was the one that was, like, in charge of, like, bringing those over. Yeah. Oh, wow. God, talk about a blast from the fucking past. Like, that DMC3... original RE4, like, pre-HD version. God, those were fucking dire port jobs. Oh yeah, here's our charge attack in action. I am gripping R1 as tightly as possible. Here I am just pressing it the bare minimum, but making use of the pressure-sensitive buttons, it glows blue and I get that very powerful horizontal swing. Again, like, controller technology has gone backwards because we decided that it was no longer worth trying to have pressure-sensitive buttons. Hell, it already went backwards when, like, people decided that the standard, like, face button layout should only have 4 buttons instead of 6. We need to bring those 2 back, and only then, will controllers truly be considered good again. I may or may not be facetious with what I am talking about. And we got a bow and arrow. We got all the items from this little blacksmith building. Let's gonna take a look around, like, the marketplace and things like that before we start investigating the gold mine. And also, we're gonna, like, take the time to, like, even buy some stuff from the shop. Because, yes, that's another thing that Onimusha 2 added. We have money, as you can see in the top right. Like, from here on, we're actually going to be coming across enemies that when we kill them, they do drop money. And that money can be used to buy us some items. Items that are generally important when it comes to giving gifts to people, because that is a crazy in-depth system that this game prides itself on. But I'll get into it more once we actually get to the point where we're able to like give gifts to other people. A nice little globe of the whole world. Some ancient documents, and over here, which is being, you can't really see it because like this NPC who's walking is blocking my view of it, but there is a chest here with a Tengu mask. And with that, we can start heading up the hill to the gold mine. Though I am going to be going up and down that hill quite a few times, because what I need to do is, not only do I need money, but I need enough money in order to buy every item that the shopkeep has here. Wasn't it like you can only gift one character max gifts or something? I remember hearing about that. There's multiple layers to that. Well, regardless, I at least have, I have a walkthrough up that has, like, the full list of, like, what sort of gifts you can give to each character and what their reactions to it are. So, that's all 1,000 gold that we had to start, which means we need 1,200 more. Oh, look at that! He also had a parrot, but because we bought his parrot, it is now in our gifts. Yep, the blue parrot. But I guess just to give a preview of like how complicated the gift giving system is and how it affects like people's like opinions of you. There are two side characters in this game who are fierce rivals with each other. That if you start giving gifts to one person, it will negatively affect the mood of the other person because he doesn't like the one that you're giving gifts to. Like, that's the kind of shit you're dealing with. Yeah, the AI for the regular samurais know that, like, the red one's trying to charge up for an EI attack, and they always become more passive so that they give him a chance to try and do me in. Hold on. There we go. It's always some matter of luck, I feel like, when trying to, like, consistently get those, criticals. Hold on, wasn't there a, Yeah, I got the telescope, so there should have been a, Alright. There it is, there's the unique mushroom I was looking for. So Persona on crack. like this is freaking like dating Sims levels of like just entire like manipulation of social stats with characters. But like none of them are ones that you can date. They're there to be like your comrades in battle. Hold on. Ah, there we go. Is it here. No, I think it went away. There's one more item that we could pick up on this trail, and it has a chance of just spawning because it's a literal, like, black beetle that crawls up along those trees.
I won't allow you to enter the mine unless you have a permit.
So, yeah, we need a permit, and we got 260 gold, so time for some grinding. Hold on. There we go. Is this critical only mode? No, it's... Criticals are just this easy to do in Onimusha 2 that it's like, it's most practical for me to do it on these easy enemies for the time being. Like, once we get to the first boss of the game, that's probably gonna be where you see me just, like, fight him normally. Also, welcome to the chat, MVC2 Hype. Oh, there's the beetle! Got it! Admittedly, because of, like, how easy it is to do criticals, I was almost contemplating maybe doing, like, this game on hard mode. But, I didn't feel like dealing with, like, the extra damage inflation and cost of everything, so that's just gonna be... I'm just focusing on playing this game with, like, default settings. And at this particular stage, grinding as much as I can until I get at least 1,200 gold so I can buy the rest of the items that are currently in the shop. At least now with, like, the souls that I have, I know I can actually upgrade my sword to level 2. Which they thankfully with this game had the bright idea to consolidate both the orb and the weapon itself into one when upgrading it, as opposed to, like, the dumb separate upgrades you had to deal with for both. And of course, Genma Onimusha did what this game did as well. Ah. Crap, come on. There we go. Makes sense Jubei uses his hand, not a gauntlet. Well, yeah. I mean, his mother was literally a demon. See, he's... That basically qualifies him as being not 100% human. Come on, what you got? Ah, hold on. There we go. That's right, that's the other thing you can do. You can technically do an Isen out of a sidestep. Which I always forget you can do just because of how much I played the first Onimusha. It makes sense in my head that the two types you have are just pressing the button the moment an enemy attack is about to hit you, or just defending against an attack and retaliating with an attack. Like, those are the two I always know about. But I forget that there's, like... Almost separate timings, I think, with, yeah, like that. Ah, hold on. Oh yeah, look at all those orbs. Oh yeah, and also sometimes it is practical to, and safest, to start a Isen if you're running past the dude because, like, the range in which it activates is so large. Like, again, they might have made the timing for this, like, a bit too easy. Just a hunch. I mean, it's still fun, though. And I'd say, at least to its benefit, Onimusha at least is a series that has had more going on with it besides just the combat. So the idea of it being monotonous from constantly doing e-sends is not likely to happen. Like if this were more of like a Devil May Cry style game and this was the thing they encouraged, like, it would have cannibalized that entire system. I played this game in critical only mode and I stopped playing it the second time you got to the Gold Village. Oh yeah. Yeah, it's just like I've appreciated the fact that they went as far as to like have a mode where it forces you to maximize on the critical system. But I could never bring myself to play through it that way because of just that level of monotony and precision. Actually, how much money do we have? Oh, look at that. Exactly 1,200. Hold on. Yep. And an extra 30. It's cool because instead of using the Oni weapons to go through doors, you need souls to open it up. Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Anyway. Actually, how many souls do we have specifically? Does it tell me? I guess not. It only tells me like once I get to like a magic mirror. Anyway, let's head inside. Gotta get the black necklace. Oh, yeah. Yeah, just all like the different necklaces and special items you get. God, like this game is so nuts with how dense it is on everything. And there we go. We bought out all of his inventory. Thanks, buddy. I never did give Magoichi the complete history books. Oh, yeah. I don't remember if I did Magoichi's, like, gift-giving and side quests or AKs. I feel like I did one or the other. Like, most of my playthroughs, I think, were focused on, like, either giving gifts to Oyu or Kotaro. Speaking of which, like, I already know which character I'm prioritizing with the gift-giving. Are all the characters even referenced in the other games, like the ones that get introduced here? So, all I really know is like
that woman gave me the help.
The weirdest one is in Dawn of Dreams, where one of the five playable characters is called Jubei Yagyu, but it is not the Jubei Yagyu we are playing as. It is instead, like, a young samurai girl.
That does it! Outside now!
Like, Dawn of Dreams is so fucking weird. Jubei, Nobunaga, and Oya, pretty sure that's it. Yeah. Well, yeah, Nobunaga was, like, obviously that existed, like, all the way back in, like, the first game. Probably did get like a reference elsewhere outside of this game considering her importance.
Prepare yourself, Magoichi.
Kind of like Dawn of Dreams, but it was a departure. It was.
You are too old fashioned.
Like, again, I feel like I'm not in the best position to like speak in depth about Dawn of Dreams just because I have not even played all the way through it. I own a copy of the game.
Magoichi Saiga is also an honorable man and is a chief of the Kishu Saiga gun team. But it is dishonorable to fight over such trifle things.
It's just like, I feel like I'd only have more to say about it.
Jubei Yagyu, the
young chief, like, if I were to, like, do another playthrough and actually get through to the end. But it just felt like, as I was going through it, that it seemed a bit too dense on, like, content and what it was wanting me to do, especially with all five characters. That, and there's also the thing that I keep hearing, but I've not looked into deeply, that apparently, like, the non-Japanese versions of Dawn of Dreams is actually artificially harder. Which, depending on how much harder it is, kind of discourages me from ever wanting to play it if that's the case. Unless there exists, like, a translation patch that just backports the English translation to the Japanese version so I could play it that way. Because otherwise, the whole thing just looks like... It just looks like they wanted to, like, just fuse Onimusha gameplay with, like, the aesthetics of, like, a Sengoku Basara. Wasn't really hard from what I remember. Okay. So, Like, if that's the case, then maybe it's as simple as, like, they do something like... Maybe it's hard in the same way that, like, the U.S., the international version of DMC1 is technically harder because they adjusted, like, the damage enemies deal to you by, like, 20% in that. Obviously, Onimusha Dawn of Dreams does not have any whacked out controller remappings like the U.S. and PAL versions of DMC1, so that's kind of nice. There's mention about a ninja. Time to look back upstairs, actually. And get an introduction to, like, my favorite side character. Almost unsurprisingly.
He's here! Get up, boy! Give us back the wallet! We told you to get up! Did you hear me? Whoa!
The wallet? Well... I gave it back to the owner.
What?
Follow the leader, monkey men. Keep up.
Wait.
You little brat!
Hey.
Get up!
God, what a punk ass.
Wait! Ouch!
That was fun.
I'm gonna kill you! Ow! Ow! Ow!
Ow! And here we go, Jubei Yagyu having to break up yet another fight. Also, nice detail, if you pay close enough attention, he is, like, holding the sword in reverse because the blunt edge can be used to just incapacitate instead of kill.
How do you know my name?
I observed you while you walked away from Yagyu Village after it had been burnt down.
Who are you?
Taro Fuma.
I see. You are a chief ninja working for the Hojo clan. Why did you come here?
I'm here because of a certain Oda clan leader.
You are scouting. Then you shouldn't play pranks.
What?
A man who shows off too much will be caught someday.
That's none of your business.
There we go. That's our final side character, although OU's not available to give any gifts to at the moment. But that's not going to stop me from gifting what I currently have to Kotaro, because I want to make sure that he is at the ready to assist us throughout the rest of the game, as well as get his playable side quest. After we get a couple more items. Another history book. Cat! Oh yeah, there it is. There's our, there's a hint of, like, the kind of... I'm sorry, I'm trying to describe these things, but I'm being enamored by, like, this, by this cat. For being an old game, it's cool the NPCs have multiple texts of dialogue. Yeah, again, this is like... Like, again, as I describe it, this is Onimusha as an adventure game. Like, in contrast to Onimusha 1 as its, as a Resident Evil-derived samurai game, and Onimusha 3 being a pure action game. Anyway, we're going to start exchanging gifts to young Kotaro here by giving him a globe, because according to the guide that I have that explains the gift-giving system, he has a unique, specific line of dialogue and reaction if the very first item you give is the globe. In fact, that dialogue that he talks about where he asks about, like, the world and if it's actually round is the hint that you're, that this is what you're supposed to give him. So we'll do that.
So it's true. The Earth really is round.
And we got some secret medicine. But wait, there's more. You can also follow that up immediately by gifting him the compass, because that makes sense.
This makes me dream of faraway lands.
And a power jewel, thank you very much. But we also got more that we could do. I'm trying to remember what is the next best thing to give him. Ah, yeah, like telescope and kaleidoscope. Those I definitely know are, those are good ones to give him. Just double checking to make sure that, yeah, those are, yeah, those are both A rank. Which, after giving him these four items, that means we will have gained at least 200 affinity points with him. Because an A-rank reaction to an item is worth 50.
Cool, this'll be fun.
Yeah. Kotaro, as you can see, is a very adventurous young lad who wants to see the world. As well as just being bored and wants, like, general amusement, hence the kaleidoscope.
Maybe I can see my home with this.
Overwhelmed with surprise and a normal bullet. Now, I want to look again just to make sure, because I don't think I have any more items I can give that have an A rank reaction, but maybe B. Okay, the cloth could be like a B rank. But I forget if it... Oh yeah. An important thing as well that I need to highlight as well, why we have an egg. What if I were to tell you, as part of this game's gift-giving system, that certain items, like the egg, will actually change with the passage of time? So the egg will turn brown, possibly even, I think, hatch. So, like, if we were to give the egg now, it would not gain nearly as much favor with anyone compared to if it had become a brown egg. Like, that is the level of insanity we are dealing with a complicated gift-giving system like this. Like, good fucking luck being able to even tell, like, what items are good for which characters outside of, like, trial and error or something. Need to look again. Okay, Folding Fan's an interesting one because it... Because if you combine it with, like, a wind chime... Which we don't have yet. I think that's that makes this more like an A rank reaction. So I'm gonna hold off on that. Just double check what all I got, because it's not just points that we need from like their reactions to giving gifts. We also need to give them like a certain amount of like gifts exchanged in order to guarantee that they'll. That will get access to their side quest. Okay. Oh yeah, we could technically give back the hair oil, but doing that actually gives us the most negative reaction possible, because he literally just gave it to us, like, just look at you like, what the fuck, dude? God. Oh yeah, Oolong Tea's a B rank, we could do that.
It's rare. Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay, an herb's nice. Let's look back through one last time to make sure. Does the pipe possibly have anything? No, no, he definitely doesn't want a pipe. Or the plant book. Wait, salt and... Oh, that's right. I technically have both. Yeah, if I give grilled fish and salt, I think that'll be worth like 100 affinity points. So we'll try that, actually. We'll first give him the salt, because I think that's still like a neutral reaction, and then give the grilled fish afterwards, and he'll be like, oh, I could combine the both of these. Now the fish still tastes good.
It's nothing special, but thanks.
Oh, don't worry. The real special stuff is later.
I'm not hungry right now.
What? Hold on. Did I do it in the wrong order? Again, this is like the complexity that comes with this. I have no fucking idea why it's like... whatever. Anyway, I think... Yeah, Tengu Mask is nothing. I could give the unique mushroom, which has a... Like, it is the one item that gives like a random result for whatever reason. Oh yeah, we could give the beetle, but it makes sense to combine it once we get, like, a watermelon. Because that makes sense. Yeah, whatever. All of, like, the A-rank items that we gave him earlier, I think is enough to offset, like, any potential negatives from, like, those last two gifts that we gave him. Anyway, let's enhance our sword. So yeah, it takes basically 7,000 just to upgrade one weapon to level 2. We can also upgrade armor. The regular armor just increases defense. Foot increases like the strength of your kick. And arm, I believe what it has to do is it either increases the strength or charge up time of your charged attacks. Which, yeah, I think this sounds nice. Although I forget... This is the problem I've always had with, like, the upgrades, where it's, like, when you start putting, like, souls into an upgrade, it's, like, if you suddenly realize that you don't have enough to get a level, or you wish that you could, like, reinvest it into, like, a different category, you can't pull out invested orbs. Didn't they simplify that in 3? Like the armor thing? Maybe. The thing that's been consistent across all 3 games is that you can upgrade your weapons. But right now, I just want to test something. I want to see how much. Because based on how... I am just shy of, like, 4,000. Like, 10 short. So, 3,990 orbs. Let's see how much that gets me for an arm honor. Oh, that's... Armor upgrades in 3 are only armor, I think. Okay. That makes more sense then. They probably just had where it's like, you have 2 categories, your weapons or just your general armor for, like, defense. Oh, well. Well, it's fine. I think I'll get, like, a few more, souls on the climb up. Oh, wait, that's right. No, I forgot. It's not... I still need to get a permit, though. That's the problem. I completely forgot. I should have come back when I had 1,300 as opposed to 1,200. because getting the permit for the mine requires that I have like an extra 100 after I buy everything out. Anyway, let's... Nice. It's always good to kill as many enemies in one shot so that you get a lot of orbs of souls released. Absorb them all at once, and that gives you a little soul bonus. It's the best part. And like, if we were playing on hard or critical mode, I'm pretty sure that they would be spawning like a lot more enemies. So that you would get a whole lot more orbs to compensate. Whoops. Oh, well, you at least got to see a down attack. But look at how little souls that was coming out of it. That was just one. That was just one orb. Like, come on. Oh, well. Okay, now we got enough money that we can buy a permit. Let's go ahead and get it from the dude inside the tavern, the inn. Yeah, I can do that. In fact, I was actually watching like a critical mode like long play video of this game, and I shit you not, like I think like early on, in that same like uphill section leading to the gold mine, I think the dude that was playing it spent upwards of like half an hour grinding nonstop against enemies for souls that I think he got like 50 some, like 50k or so out of it, and a whole lot of money, like over 10k in gold. And somehow, like, doing all that, this was like for like an S rank run of all things. And that was still somehow enough. Okay, come on, let's get all you guys down here. Ooh, Ford wants. Yeah, I'm almost, again, I am almost wishing that I had decided to start on hard mode, but I would rather not have, like, gone with a difficulty where I am potentially unprepared for, like, okay, a difficulty spike as a result of, like, that level of, like, difficulty and damage scaling. Anyway, it's time for us to go on to the next section, the gold mines.
Tapped. Monsters.
A woman wearing armor went in there. I tried to stop her, but...
What?
All right, inside we go. Inside here, though... A demon wall scroll. A pupil of Guildenstern created the Mozun from bright moss under the ground. Ah, yes, Guildenstern, a name that continues to crop up across all three games. Even though I'm pretty sure Guildenstern qualifies as Sir not appearing in this game because he makes no physical appearance. Ah, crap. Yeah, okay, but that works. And we got our first secret technique. Which, to put simply, secret techniques you get for your weapons are done... Once you get the scroll that unlocks it, you do down up on the D-pad and attack. And it results in this. A triple slash auto combo. It's pretty neat. Okay. I'm gonna keep doing what I can to max this out. Oh, I'm so close. Okay, so bit 7. Okay, so I guess getting armor from level 1 to 2 takes about 5,000. This was kind of the obnoxious thing I had to deal with. Like, not just for this game, but also Onimusha 1. Like, I genuinely do not think there are even any, walkthroughs out there that bother to explain, like, what the costs are for upgrading your weapons, armor, etc. to, like, each different level. It's annoying that I kind of have to, like, figure this out on my own. Alright. But now we gotta get ready for a new enemy. Some proper demons. Who are also jobbers and very easy to quick kill with Isen. Some weirdo reptilian demons who were also in the Onimusha 2 teaser that you unlocked in the first game. Yep. Like so. Like, it is so easy to, like, prepare for getting an E-Sen on them, because when they do their roar, it's always followed with a lunge, and that lunge is, like, your cue to just annihilate them. Except at that time. Ooh! Yeah, just, like, these are chumps. Again, like, this whole, like, Isen only, like, mentality is, I'm very sure, gonna just dry up completely as soon as I get to the boss of this area. That doesn't mean I won't stop trying to get Isens on the first boss. But I might just give up after a while. $100 gold, nice. Alright. Now then, here's a cutscene. Is our ninja friend? Yes, he is! He's here to assist.
I'm here to save you, Jubei.
And obviously, if you had decided to prioritize giving gifts to, like, Mangoichi or Eke, naturally one, or I think both of them would, like, show up. Or at least, like, they both are in the same cutscene together once you survive this. Yeah, Kotaro's great. Just, I feel it's only fitting. After Onimusha 1 had, like, the buddy dynamic of Samanosuke and Kaede, like, why not do the same with Jubei and Kotaro? A samurai and a ninja. Like, name a better duo, really.
Wait, Kotaro.
Don't worry. You can count on me.
Yeah, you do you, buddy. All right. A little scroll talking about, like, the Oni orbs. And we're gonna get a new weapon. This time? a spear. That said, we're not really going to be using this one too much because... Well, I might still use it because there is like a door that's coming up that has a seal that can only be broken if we have this weapon equipped. And we're still going to be killing enemies with E-Sens anyway, as long as we can, so why not? Ah, fuck. Ah. But as you can see, it's very different in its timing. As well as range, you know? I mean, it is very single enemy focused. You can imagine why I would rather continue to stick with the, like, with using the Buraito. The Buraito, which obviously is supposed to be, like, it's supposed to sound like it's, bright. All right, let's continue. Oh.
Gutaro.
You're starting to slip there, buddy.
You see? I will never be defeated.
I literally saw you fall on the ground, asshole.
Don't know anything yet. Reckless behavior will always get you into trouble.
Ha! Look who's talking. You're the one who's trying to destroy Nobunaga all by yourself.
I have nobody to cry for me anymore. But you, members of the Fuma clan, must be looking forward to your safe return.
They're ninjas. I'm pretty sure that they're, like, willing to accept that he may or may not die. Because death is just a regular fact of life for them.
Kotaro.
Eh, whatever. He'll get better. Anyway. The seal is broken. And I think from here on, we're... Yeah, let's switch back to... Wait, no. Actually, I want to try something with this when we get to the boss. Just because that's usually the weapon I've seen used when trying to go for criticals on him. Let's... There we go. Yeah, I'll hold off on upgrading anymore. At least until I complete this boss. All right. Let's hope I can pull this off. Because it's time to face a huge enemy that, while we can't kill him in one hit, we can still get multiple criticals on him, which is why this game is even possible to play through with the E-Sen mechanic, and they have an entire difficulty devoted to it.
What do you think you are doing? How dare you invade my territory?
He has an eye and a mouth on his crotch.
Why did you come here?
I'm looking for a woman. I have no quarrel with you.
Who do you think you're talking to? Do you think you are equal to one from the demon clan?
Not equal. Better.
Ooh! Ooh, talking some shit right there.
Your
Oh. Hold on. Ah, crap. Crap, I get the timing right. Ah, fuck off. Ah, shit. I am...
Party time!
Yeah, I am botching this pretty bad. Katara, please help me. Screw it, I'll just use the medicine right now, even though I kind of wish I didn't have to. How is that not right? Wait, are you still... Oh god, that's right, I didn't even have the spear equipped. Oh my god, I'm pretty... Oh, crap. Fucker. You know, screw it. I'm done with trying to... In fact, actually... I feel bad about losing that much health from him. Even with Kotaro coming in for the assist, I'm just gonna reload. And I'll just fight him like normal. Like, as... Again, this is what I warned about. I may have a relatively easy time getting Isen chains on the regular enemies, but I am out of my depth when it comes to doing the same on bosses. Like, I'm hopeless on that front. Oh well. At least I can skip cutscenes in this, unlike the first game. Oh, finally got a purple orb out of it. Ah. Crap. I was just wanting him to break it. Come on, asshole. Yeah, let's just have him break these for the sake of getting some extra gold out of it, if possible. There we go. Oh, wait, I think that's it. Yo, Onimusha mode time! Charge attacks by themselves are pretty good as well when it comes to just you want something reliable for, Wow, two purple orbs from that. Ah, fuck, whatever.
Party time.
At least I think he'll get in on, like, the ending cutscene now that I think about it. I forget, does it still have the same system where, like, the magic is... Yes, it is. Okay. A cool design for a power-up mode. Yeah, it's, Ari, I think you missed it when I got to the end of Onimusha 1. And you'd probably agree with me on this. But, like... Nero's Devil Trigger in DMC 5 clearly had to have been designed by someone that was involved with the Onimusha games. Because it has some very strong, like... Onimusha form vibes to it. Like, just like dark humanoid demon bluish skin with white hair. Like that aesthetic. There he goes. Okay, so let's try and space things out and get some regular charge attacks in. There we go. Wait, how is that still not enough for a... Got it. Look at that. Look at that invisibility at work. Got it. All right. I'm still myth we didn't get Hoodie Nero DT. Oh God, yeah. And there we go, he's defeated. We didn't kill him the fast way by chaining a bunch of E-Sens, but honestly, like, it's whatever. Got a whole bunch of orbs.
That was fun.
Well, he's out. And we got a ton of gold, too. Holy shit. Okay, so... how much did that put us at? 2,800. Not bad, not bad. And I did not need to use a single herb or medicine. Not like he doesn't have the hood in his design anymore. True. Yeah, but whatever. Like, that taunt that you earn for him from completing Bloody Palace, like, that still has the hood. That's a fun one. $200. We'll talk to that farmer, that peasant, a little bit later. Right now, we gotta keep getting all this gold. Got a mirror. Ah. Okay, hold on. I agree on his DT being reminiscent of Onimusha, at least. Yeah, for sure. Which... I definitely appreciate that as a way to, like, even though Nero now has a traditional DT, at least now you could say that... you could at least say that, like, even with, like, a traditional DT, his still has a look that is distinct from even Dante and Virgil, you know? Oh yeah, that was also like the secret technique that we got for the Hyojin Yari. Our little spear, which should be... yep, just a rapid forward thrust. Hey buddy, how you doing?
Hey.
What would I give for a crossover of those series, though? Oh, man. Yeah.
The monsters forced us to work in the mines as slaves. I'm the only one...
Have DMC crossover with Sengoku Basara, like, but even more literally, just so that they have an excuse to, like, reuse that whole Devil Kings nonsense that they... that, like, you remember that shit when, like, the first Sengoku Basara was getting brought outside Japan? Capcom literally had no idea how to go about, like, bringing that over to the West, so they instead rebranded it as Devil Kings with, like, the same logo font as Devil May Cry 1.
I feel fine now.
And somehow tried to get that as, like, a way to, like, possibly get people hooked.
Might have been taken into the hole.
The hole?
Yes, it's inside the gold mine, but the opening is blocked. There is one way you can enter the hole. Please, use this to open the cover.
What's that?
I don't know exactly. But you can open the cover if you place this on top somehow.
Hmm.
I just found it lying around there and I kept it. Please, take it.
Inside of the gold mine?
Yes. I have to go now. Thank you.
Now I'm thinking about that, everything. The whole skit. Whatever. Just fill the whole hole filler.
Okay, check this.
Thank you.
Does Ghost Stories have the greatest English dub of any anime? Quite possibly. Anyway, we're back. We could go back to the mine now and put this ring in the hole. But obviously, we still got more to do. We got side quests that we can do here in town, actually. I'm still not big on using the Hyojin Yari because of just the way Isens feel when using it. Like, it's so much more narrow compared to the Burrito, like, horizontal slash where it just has a wide hitbox. So let's put some more into armor. Okay, I'm going to assume that it takes like 9 or 10,000 just to upgrade the regular armor to level 2. But it's whatever. We're gonna be doing a lot more side stuff now before we actually progress back to the main plot, including getting some more money, because the shop is restocked now. And how much money did we have again? We have 3,900. Okay, that's not too bad. We only need like another 1,200. Oh, hey, look at that. The egg that we were holding on to, it actually hatched into a chick. That's okay. I was confusing two different things. I thought it was like the egg browns, but no, it's like you hold on to the egg, it gets warm, and it hatches. But you can get like a different colored egg, and like a similar thing happens where it will eventually hatch. Okay, so let's go get some more money. Maybe some more souls as well so we can finish upgrading our armor to level 2. Oh, and also let's get back our sword. Brighto, level 2. Oh god, that's right. They replaced the enemies with these freaking ninjas. They're just as obnoxious here as they were in first game. Hold on. Shit. There, okay. That's right. Okay. Fire arrow. Shit. Okay, I think it's that particular. Fuck. Come on. Yeah, it's that one. That's the best chance I have to actually get a hit in on them, but I think I would have easier time just going back inside the mine proper and dealing with like those reptile fiends. Oh, it's a little dog. All right. Unfortunately, with the way that this game has a whole gift-giving system, I feel like it's a missed opportunity. They do not have like a derived system of it where you just feed animals that you pass by. I like how most older games tend to just throw a simple introduction scene with the enemy at you. No big tile drops, just here, fight that. True! And in the case of Hideki Kamiya games especially, they not only do that, but they also like to just go full on, here's the enemy, they're going into an attack, the cutscene ends with them literally landing an attack, so you better think fast, fucker. Just, oh man. Okay, just please tell me I can still find the regular just the regular reptile. Oh, wow, he's here. Oh, fuck. Oh, God, this was probably a bad idea. Ah, crap. Crap. Ugh. Well, thanks for killing him for me, dude. I guess.
Piece of cake.
Yeah. You know, maybe coming in here for this was actually not a good idea. But it's like just, but like the weak fodder enemies are all gone now. The ones that I'm most used to. Like, why? Why you gotta be like this? Ah, how'd I miss? Ah, fuck. Shit. Oh, just barely. Oh, wow. Oh, God. Okay. Well, and they didn't even drop money. The bastards. Like, come on. Why you gotta do this to me? I just want over 5,100. That's better. Ah, hold on. See, it is a lot easier to kill bigger enemies, tougher enemies with Isen if you have, like, a weak fodder enemy to, like, start a chain with. Jeez. I was desperately worried that, like, these things were no longer spawning. At least the big dudes are producing a lot of orbs. But I still don't have near the amount of money I need for this. Might as well grind this spot while I can. Ah, fuck. Oh, God, it's all of these. Three? Oh, my God. Okay, good. There's a lone one. Whew. Yeah, this is the best chance I have. Oh, nice, nice, nice. You know, they're not... Oh, yeah, just, like, the amount of money I'm getting is not anywhere close to, like, what I would normally want. But I do appreciate the amount of orbs being dropped, like, for their souls. Like, now I definitely have enough to upgrade my armor to level 2. How much have we got? 46, okay. Probably about 500 more. I just hope when I get back to Imasho Town and I stop by the inn that, like, these side characters are actually back in the spots they normally are supposed to. Got it. Oh man, how did that not connect? Okay, come on. Oh shit. Maybe a block he sent? Oh fuck. Okay, that worked. Awesome. Oh man, I am so close. Come on. Wait, I pressed the button. Shit. How is that not perfect? There we go. You just gotta figure out on the fly what is more practical, a regular E-Sen or a block E-Sen. Just how it is. Okay, I'll try this again. Wait, there's no more? Oh my god, don't tell me there's like limited respawns in the mines. You gotta be kidding me. There are. You son of a bitch. Okay, I seem to have a pretty good handle on doing that. Yeah. Block Isen on that particular underhand swing is pretty good. Oh god, it's those floating orbs as well. You bastard. Shit. God damn it. No, shit. Fine, I'll do this instead. God damn it, I don't like this. Oh yeah, and I had that power jewel I never used. Shit. Alright, fine. I'll just use an herb right here. I'm close to 5100. I could probably get a bit more gold if I just persevere down the mountain. Ugh. Alright. Wait, hold on. There is a magic mirror in there. I could just upgrade my armor right now. Let's do that. But get that topped off. I figured that also ties into like your physical appearance changing as well. Yeah, it looks a bit different, I think. Yeah, all right. Well, let's head back to town. We just need like 40 more gold. Like, let's just hope that like these ninjas drop them. I'm not even gonna bother like fishing for Isen out of them. Oh, chop their mask off. Okay, that's 30. They still give a decent amount of orbs, even if you do... If you don't get them with an E-Sen. I guess that's fine. Fishing for E-Sen sounds like a sitcom title. Eh. Yeah, I don't need that the last purple orb right now. It's better for me to just save it for the future. Anyway, now let's time to buy out the shop a second time. And then do a side quest. Unless, wait, no, that's the inn. Okay, yeah, the characters do all return to, like, their normal spots, so... Oh yeah, thank God for the magic well. We'll get that foot armor to level 2 eventually. Yeah, just stuff like that going through the mine is, like... Again, it's a big part of, like, why I wouldn't really be able to bring myself to do a full playthrough of this on critical mode. The people that are able to do it, though, like this in Onimusha 3, like, God bless them. But I am not one of those. Oh, look, and he has a new parrot. Alright, time to buy some stuff. Lemon, take that. Hair ornament, sure. A fairy tale book. Another history book. Silver armor for OU only. Kameo Hachimaki, which is for Kotaro only. Western boots for Magoichi. And Fudo leg guards for Eke. And a red parrot. Love potion. And artwork. Excellent. Oh yeah, let's also like get the quest started, which I think can be done here as well. It's one of these characters. Father is dangerously ill, is repeatedly saying he wants to eat a thing called melon every day. Came to this town hoping to find one, but they got jack shit, man. What I have now is only this, what I found on the street. Okay, time for an item trading quest. Turn to the bar. Through this newly connecting door. Like, yeah, it used to be blocked by the guy that sold us the permit. So now we can easily go back and forth between the two buildings without having to step outside. Drinking so much, I think I'd rather eat sweets for a change. Do you have some for me? Well, I do have some, chalk. This is important, by the way. This is a necessary step.
Why are you giving me this?
It's because we need that particular item. But hey, just to make it up to him... We'll give him some leg guards.
This is all mine!
Kyojin Yari Tech 1. Ooh! Oh god, yes! Okay. I need to actually look that up because... This book allows you to execute a powerful charge attack by holding down the R1 button. Right, yeah, because it's... I think the general idea is that, yeah, when you get a magic item, you get a default charge attack. But when you get, like, these tech manuals for different weapons, it unlocks, a new power level for that charge move. Now, find Maguichi sitting at the table. Like to study a wide range of topics, trade with you for any item that may help to increase my knowledge. Yeah, so that's your hint that, like, those history books are valuable for him. But right now, what we need to do is give him Tale of the Heikei. Or the Heikei, I guess. Yeah, that's how you pronounce it. Story depicting Taira Minamoto War and the fall of the Taira family, told by Biwa Minstrel.
Books are my passion.
Looks to be in a good mood. And then, just because I went to all the trouble of getting these particular, like, armor pieces for the characters. Have some Western boots, buddy.
Ooh, my feet, thank you.
And, oh yeah, Brito Tech 1. God, yes. Oh, we are moving up. This is good. God, this is just like, even after the stream playthrough, it almost makes me not to want to continue to Onimusha 3. Like, I just want to keep playing this over and over, you know? See all the different scenarios again, because, like, all kinds of events can happen in different ways throughout an entire playthrough. It's good to see you. Actually saw a family walking together a while ago. Well, glad to know that you're in such good spirits. I got some for you. Two things, actually.
Wow! I finally get to see one of these!
Well, that was some weird audio clipping. Spirit is very high with joy, and we have a melon. Also, because we got, like, another armor piece for you. Here, new headband and scarf. It's got an iron plate on it. That'll definitely, like, make sure your forehead is protected. You don't want to get any cuts on there and, like, blood dripping into your eyes.
This is rare. My friends will be jealous.
Really? It's rare to get, like, a different colored scarf and a headband with an iron plate? Ah, whatever. Ooh, Brito Tech 2. I think that means, hold on, let me look. That has to mean super powerful. Yep, we got all three levels of the charge attack now for the Brito. That's, oh, that is so good. Now then, time to finally give the melon to that dude, and we will get a new item out of it that is the first of several color-coded necklaces. Don't know how to thank you, but I'll return the favor. We meet again later. So, yeah, we don't get it now. But as he said, he'll return the favor later. Once we see his father, who is, like, rejuvenated, that's when we will get what is called the Orange Necklace, which reveals hidden clusters of souls, essentially. Now, let's actually, I'm gonna save again just to make sure. Yeah, we're making some very good progress, even if it's not much in the way of, like, story itself. But, like, as with any good adventure game, like, actual exploration and, like, doing quests and whatnot, like, your due diligence with that is going to be helpful. Oh, like, yeah, look at that. You can see he's kind of got, like, the different colored headband now. You'll get a better view of it once we start another gift exchange. Let's see. What do we got now? Oh yeah, since our egg hatched, we could give him the chick. Here you go, buddy. See, new headband, new scarf.
Cute chick. It will be my good traveling companion.
Treat him well, buddy. And a magic jewel. Hell yes. So, what else can we give him that we have now? Oh wait, the fairy tale book apparently. Yeah, I guess that makes sense. He is very much a child at heart. Just keep maximizing. Oh yeah. That's how we know now that he is actually our best bud. That's when he's hanging overhead and drops down. That means that you have like hit like a new threshold with the with your friendship. Like he is your buddy now. Like above all. Oh yeah, and also like just looking back through like the list of items and like their reactions that Kotaro has. It's a good thing we gave him the chick now, because bizarrely enough, if we let it grow even more into a chicken, it would get less affinity points from him as opposed to it just being a regular chick. But it would probably meant a lot more if we gave it to like another character. Again, adding more and more to like this game's insane complexity with the gift giving system. Okay. Yeah, I guess we could give him the lemon now. That's a B rank. That's still good. Yeah.
It's just what I wanted.
More medicine, that's good. We could use that for sure. I forget this, the mirror. Oh, mirror is a B rank as well. Why not? It'd still be good to get some B rank items out of this, especially if it means more like healing items. Raises his thumb. Yep, another herb, that's pretty good. Yeah, he doesn't want the parrot, though. Nor the plants book. Okay, we have definitely tapped out. But yeah, that was a successful round of gift giving, I would say. Let's get to the next side quest. You can wander town, talk to a few key individuals to get some useful items. Still no OU, so we obviously cannot give her any gifts at the moment, but we'll get there eventually. Give it time. Go up the steps to the marketplace, woman by the door. I think that's her. There's a man who walks back and forth in front of me. He gives me the creeps. Is it you? I was afraid, but today I made up my mind. I'll make a declaration of love. Oh no. Oh no. Over there. Still, I should take a rain check. I'll give this to you. I was thinking it could be a present. Awesome. Oh, but no, we're gonna talk to her instead. Men are all so easy. They all want the same thing. And another history book. Now I'll talk to the man near the stalls. That's what I want. That's what I want. Oh, I'm removing weeds because I'd like to live in a clean town. Yeah, I can respect that. Okay, I don't think that's the right one. Okay. No, I gotta keep talking to this dude. I'll give you this just to leave me alone. Thank you. That's all I wanted. Just another magic gem. Magic duel. Whatever. There. Now our magic and health meters, like maximum length, are at parity. Okay. Next stop, the bar. Or at least outside the bar. I really wish those magic wells that you sometimes find next to a... To a save mirror. I wish they also released, like, yellow orbs so you could heal yourself sometimes. I kind of hate going around with, like, my... Excuse me, with my health, like, currently at a third of its max capacity. You're like a dream. Can't you feel my heart beating? Yada yada. Weird. Wasn't that supposed to be her? She's supposed to give me something. Huh. That's bizarre. Unless it's a weird thing where secret medicine is like an item you can only hold one of at a time. Alright, we got ourselves a pick. You know, I'll save. I'll use the secret medicine and then talk with her again to see if she gives me, like, another... Like, if that's what it's expecting me to do. And once that's done... Then we can actually go back to the mines and, like, progress the story for real. Alright, now we'll see if that works. And if it somehow doesn't, I will just reload the save. Because I, much like with elixirs and RPGs, I have a hoarding problem. What? Oh, wait. Oh, it was the wrong lady the entire time. It's one that's just walking up and down the street. God damn it. That explains it, no wonder, because the other one wasn't saying exactly my type or whatever the phrase is. Let's actually load that up, because, yeah, it should be possible to, like, get, like, another secret medicine on top of that. Like, why not? Okay, where is she? Oh, no, I see her. She coming down the stairs? Yeah, she better. Give me my goddamn medicine. Yep, it's her. Is this for you? Yes, I can get two secret medicines. Excellent. Now, with all that said and done, we can continue up the mountain. And let's take a look at, like, our new charge attacks. Because, oh boy, this is gonna be awesome. Yep, like so. Oh! Freaking anti-air, look at that! Yeah, at some point you don't even really need to be, like, relying on, like, the Isen mechanic for everything. Like, you have this as a backup. Again, like, it's the big reason why Genma Onimusha is better than the PS2 original. Because it knew that charge attacks and the Onimusha mode, like, do a lot to, like, make the combat feel more well-rounded outside of critical hits, you know? Okay, we got some dice. Excellent. Now I guess we'll just work our way back to that room past the first boss. Just some extra gold in the meanwhile. Ugh. Yeah, like those charge attacks are so good. Even to its credit, it's like, like, each level of charge attack is a different type of move compared to what you have in Genma Onimusha, because I think it's just hold on. You know, we're actually gonna switch to the bow for this. Like so. Still the same way of dealing with them like in Onimusha 1. Nice, nice. Yeah, just save the Isen chains for the really weak enemies where you know it's easy to get one started on. Oh wait, hold on. I want to say there's something you can do as well by combining the charge attacks with with an E-Send if you manage to pull it off. Ah, oh, come on. Damn it. Yeah, I think it might just be it adds more power to it. I would not be surprised if that's the case. Very nice. And look at that, we're actually about back to full health. Yeah, okay, we'll just head back to the spot that we need to use the red ring. Oh god, it's these things. Oh! Oh yeah, oh wow, you... Like, that was like the best Isen timing you had on them, like, back in Onimusha 1. But like, that also just highlights even more how much more lenient, like, the timing window is. On these roly demons. Yeah. Oh yeah. Oh, but now I'm missing the timing on that. Shit. Alright. Oh yeah. There we go. Yeah, still just those ninja demons. They're still the most obnoxious to deal with, by far. Collecting information is one of a ninja's jobs. If you find anything interesting, I guess you know who you should talk to. Actually, let me double check. I got dice. Those seem like fun and games that he would be into. Yeah, they are. It's a B rank item. So, we'll just give those to him right now. Here you go.
Care to test your luck?
Raises his thumb. And fire arrows. Thank you. All right, get foot armor to level 2. Nice. Jeez, we're already at like, we have collected over 30k souls in total in just like these starting 2 hours. Oh, here it is. Yo, Magoichi. Oh, fuck off. Damn it! Oh, you son of a bitch. I'm trying to get a better angle, dude. Oh, fucker. Damn it. Oh, fuck. Get. You assholes. Are you kidding? Get me out, fucker. You son of a bitch. Oh my god, this is awful. I'm just trying to get things. No. I just want. Alright, time to go sicko mode on you bastards! God, that was embarrassing. Like, I cannot... You sucking... Fucking goddamn you! I just need my purple orbs back, please. Why do they have to take so long? God, what an embarrassment. Whatever. I don't know why you're still following me, dude. Alright, red ring time. Now this next area coming up. This might look a tad bit familiar to you all, but it's a pretty cool moment. Mysterious cave revealed its entrance. Go into the hole? Yes. Let's do this.
As you are going to die soon, why not now?
Oh, shut up. Well, that was easy. Oh, wait, there's another one. Yeah, level 2 is pretty good as, like, a more guaranteed way to knock these dudes down. It's a demon world. Weird wording. I agree. This game's translation is pretty goofy. Like, it's not just the voice acting. Just, ugh, translation leaves a lot to be desired. Again, this is the series that saw... The game is called Onimusha, yet the actual Onis are translated into being ogres. Oh god, yeah, I almost said something about it, but I am so glad you also thought that it sounded a lot like Agni and Rudra. like it's brothers or something. Like, I just wanted to, like, just impersonate Dante and go, no talking. Good. It's real silly. Anyway, up the spiral staircase we go, made of bone. Okay, can I? No. Ah, crap. I just want... Give me a fucking attack I know I can block, Isen. Shit. No, so close to asking you, what's a sigh? Oh shit, fuck. Fine, just an herb. Just one herb. It's not what I wanted, but I feel like the environment kind of didn't allow for it. Look at that! We're back in the castle from Onimusha 1! Like, how fucking awesome is that, man? Oh, yeah. Like, it is... It obviously makes some amount of sense that they would do this, considering they had to have had, like, the 3D render assets that they used for the backgrounds in the first game, but even then, they changed up, like... certain aspects of it visually quite a lot.
Jubei, I'm sorry about earlier.
I'm sorry. I'm Canadian, even though I'm supposed to be a ninja.
Please, let me work with you. I hate Nobunaga as much as you do.
Yeah, it is cool when it's used to, like, great emotional effect.
Village could be attacked at any time. If that happens, a lot of my friends may die.
Mm-hmm.
So please let me help.
Yeah, Dark Don't Souls 3 worry. Had it, technically. Dead Space 2 had you revisiting the Onimusha, but it has, like, a bunch of, like,
right.
Biohazard, like, quarantining, like, tarp and like, blockades and stuff all over it because it is literally just like a hazard point. Metal Gear Solid 4, famously, with you going back to Shadow Moses. Like, it's really cool when that sort of thing happens. And now we're back here in what used to be Inabayama Castle, but now it's called Gifu Castle because in the wake of this game, of like the first game, you completing it, like what happened was that Nobunaga still killed like the clan that ruled this castle and took over it for himself. That, like, that's the idea. Oh, got it. I wasn't expecting that I would be able to E-Sen on that particular move, but I did. Nice, nice. Got some incense. Ow, you fucker. Ooh, just narrowly dodged that. Okay. Yeah, it's just the same castle, but more dilapidated because Nobunaga still wrecked this place regardless. Oh. Oh god, it's one of these. Yeah, this is the other kind of trick box, so I have to... This is basically like a Sudoku type thing. So, let's see. What's the solution? You have to place four numbered titles in the corner sections. Yeah, they all have to equal 15. So, top row... Yep. Like I said, it's literally just fucking Sudoku. And we got the right half of a bronze mask. That room you were in, actually, that used to be like your main save room in the first game as well. God, come on. Fine, I'll just do this instead. I complained about this when I went through Onimusha 1, but I probably get that it was a technical limitation, but I sincerely do wish that it was possible to just instantly swap between sword and like a ranged weapon at any point, rather than having to juggle between the two, like through selecting them in a menu. Like, it's so cumbersome. Like, there's enough of a lengthy pause each time. How is it not? Like, what angle do I need to be at in order to hit the bastard? Okay, apparently that corner. Fine. All right. At least the game's giving me these weak dudes. A wonder flower. All right. Back through these rooms again. Oh! Oh, nice. Use the talisman to seal that little ninja in place. Yeah, you're not a bad fighter yourself, even if you are kind of a slob in, like, all other aspects of your life. Door's locked. Cherry blossom is drawn above the keyhole. Yeah, that's a reminder. You see that right there, how this was from the game that took a lot of cues from Resident Evil, because he had similar shit just like that.
freaking doors that required like specific color coded or like sign specific keys and whatnot. It was so silly. It was Resident Evil in a Japanese castle, and I would not have had it any other way.
Alright.
Door's locked. I need a special item, which I don't have. Oh! Nice! We're back to some regular-ass samurai enemies now. And a fire arrow. Yeah, let's invest some into Hyojin Yari, even if I'm not going to use it much. You know, it's still nice to have all these things upgraded eventually for the sake of completion, because I have a broken brain. Ooh. All right. God, yeah, just going back through this area was so cool the first time. It's a pretty good, like, blurring effect on that ghost. Must have a grudge against Nobunaga as I do. Oh, nice. That allows me to see the dead. Thank God. Okay. Caught in the evil energy haunting this well. That sucks. Obtain the Purify Charm in this castle. Then I guess you'll be free then. Cool. Yeah, again, like that translucency effect for the ghost. It's like, yeah, putting the PS2's like weirdly powerful use of alpha transparencies to good use. Like, holy shit, man. Only gave you the purify charm, which I'm pretty sure, which I'll be able to get to if I just head upstairs. Oh no, get out, get out, get out. Oh, come on, please, 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 please. Are you kidding? I can't hit it? What the hell? Ah, fuck off.
I'll give you a hand.
Yes, please. Thank you. Where the hell were you, man? Nice.
Ready?
Yeah, we're a pretty all right team. Okay. And now we're up on the second floor. Yeah, can't go down there because the stairs are destroyed. Though to be fair, those stairs were also non-existent in like the first game, so eh. Purify Charm, that's what we needed. Thank you. Got it. Seems to respond to the Oni power. You can see ground shaking inside. Yeah, so that's like another weapon that we're gonna need for that. Yeah, not gonna waste time trying to get E-Sense, especially when I have a good chance of doing that particular move to just use like a ground fatal blow on them, and that will just produce like some orbs that I need most, like some big health items. Hey, look at that! Look at Magoichi helping me from the ground floor. Like God, again, this is like just one of the coolest parts about it. Like even if you aren't giving gifts all the time to every single like major character, they're still active in your quest. Come on. What do you got? Ah, fuck. There we go. That's the underhanded slash I was looking for. That was good. All right. Ah, crap. Nice. Okay. We got the Purified Charm. We can go back to that spirit and help him. Nice. Yeah, just the more I am reminded of the things that I greatly appreciate about Onimusha 2, the more curious I am to see how my opinion on 3 changes. Because as much as I really love action games, you know, like, I never, like, came away from Onimusha 3 thinking, oh man, this is the best of the trilogy. It has a pretty sick opening CG video, though, when you boot up the game. But then again, like, that's common knowledge. Like, literally everyone who's played the Onimusha games knows that. So now we got both halves of the bronze mask, which I'm pretty sure goes straight into that particular door that we passed on the first floor. Oh yeah, we should at least like try out like the Hyojin Yari's like different charge attacks while we're at it, I think. Yeah, it's still a launcher. Hold on. Yeah, it's still like a horizontal swipe. Oh, I could not see that. Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's still a neat weapon, but it still wouldn't be anywhere close to, like, what I would like to use, you know? Like, nothing beats a good old sword. Huh? Wow, I didn't realize my health got that low, actually. Oh, come on. Ah, screw it. I just was not getting it for whatever reason. Actually, hold on. Are there any more of those lizard men demons that I could get some souls from? We'll try the foyer one last time. Oh no, they're just on the... Fine. Shoot him! Oh fuck, who cares? No. I'm not gonna bother. Not the best right now, but whatever. Oh, hey, dude. You fucking bitch. God damn you. That's it. We're getting out of here. Fun fact, this door is also, like, what led to the arena of the final boss fight in the last game. Nice. Okay, now we'll just go through. That's fine. Oh,
well,
shit.
Well. Foolish woman. The fate of Odani Castle is already
been decided. Oh god, I forgot this dude was still in this game, technically. He was also in the first game, and later became the primary antagonist of Dawn of Dreams. A dude who goes by a different name, but like, is based on historical figure Hideyoshi Toyotomi.
You're disgusting. Touch me again and you'll regret it.
Oh, so serious. You're feisty. As always.
God.
Anyway, this is the will of our lord, so I cannot allow you to leave this castle.
His voice actor, I feel, is intentionally or unintentionally trying to, like...
Jubei Yagyu, you're still alive?
Channel, like a gay tone of voice or inflection.
The clan who attacked Yagyu Village.
Wait, that was the main baddie? At least as far as I remember.
Well,
again, I didn't get to the end of Dawn of Dreams. But since the whole point of Dawn of Dreams is that it took place... I remember him to be in the final CG scene of 3, though. Yeah, well, that seemed to be the whole idea that they went for, was that they were trying to establish the fact that just like in history, he was meant to be, like, Nobunaga's successor. Okay, come on. I'm trying to get this. Ah, crap. There we go! That's what I wanted! Got some medicine. Now we just go through here. Hopefully we can very closely get caught up with... Wait, hold on. I think before we get to, like, finally caught up to OU, I think it's about to happen. I think we're gonna get introduced to the best character of the whole game. Yes, we are! Yes!
Thank you for staying.
Oh, yes!
Who are you? Oh, I'm glad you asked. My name is...
Sononawa!
Gogen
Dantes!
Swordsman of all demons.
Fuck yes, you are the best character ever! Oh, yeah! This fucking flamboyant ass demon swordsman who is your self-proclaimed rival. And is a large ham, and I can tell because of that, this is the best English voice actor that the dub ever had. Because he knew. Also, that is such a Keita Amamiya design. Like, that is something that would totally exist in like a... in like Garo or something to that effect. Oh crap, come on. Oh. Unfortunately, he seems to be kicking our ass quite a bit. Ow. You son of a bitch. Oh wait, there's a follow-up on that? Oh my god, there is! But yeah, this dude, he's basically toying with us. Okay, no, hold on. I'm just gonna... Because I'm trying to remember. I'm pretty sure that this whole thing is supposed to be a fight that you're not able to win. Yeah, it is. Yeah, just... I just gonna go... Oh! Yeah, you just gotta keep hitting him as many times as you can until OU saves you. Come on.
How sad. Cowards never triumph and heroes never run. But I suppose that it can't be helped. You are too weak to take me on.
I fucking love this character so much. He is the reason to play Onimusha 2 Samurai's Destiny. Yo! Yo, thanks for backing me up while I make my daring escape, dude. Just don't die, please.
Jubei.
Hmm.
I know her.
Do you? Hmm. Oh, well. God, but that's such a cool moment. It won't be the last time we see Gogen Dantes, obviously. Hold on, is there anything in this tunnel that's hidden or something? No, not here. Alright, fine. Time to head out.
Let me use the orb that you wear around your neck.
Okay.
Now, looking ahead, just to know for sure what we have to look forward to on the, according to the walkthrough. We're actually going to be going back to Imasho Town for the third time, and I also believe for the last time, which means I am going to spend the rest of the time that I can manage while streaming this to get enough money to buy out the shop one last time, get any last items and side quests out of the way, and then after that's all done, hit the next story trigger that moves us on to the rest of the game. Oh my god, yes. Yes, I forgot about this. We got a literal, like, robot stallion. This is... Ugh.
What's this?
This... Oh, yeah. This had to have been, like, another Keitama Miya joint. Like, oh, man. Seriously, that's something that we need more of. We need, like... more games that are just pure Keita Amamiya, because like I'm Get just on. Like this upcoming visual that we got going on, I feel is just straight out of like Come the on. Kind of works that he's done. Oh, man. This game is fucking magical. Like, it's not enough that they couldn't have just found the regular horse and rode across the countryside like any other normal, like samurai fiction story. No, it's a magical, like, robot metal horse. This game, man. And this doesn't even go off the deep end nearly as much as Onimusha 3 does, where it's literally time-traveling demons and Jean Renault gets sent back to Sengoku era Japan.
Thank you. By the way,
this series just got progressively more and more silly.
My name is Oyu. I'm from Odani.
So you were related to Asai. I see. Nobunaga is taking down Asai right now.
We had no chance against his army, so I went to Gifu Castle to kill Nobunaga myself. But I was caught.
I understand. I must take revenge on Nobunaga for the Yagyu clan.
Well.
Yep. All these warriors have some vested interest in wanting Nobunaga dead. Oni 3 is the reason that Renau became one of my favorite actors, really.
Anyway.
Makes sense. Which, speaking of, this is actually, I think, like an anecdote related to the sales of the Onimusha series that explains why Jean Renau even got casted for that game. This game we're playing, Onimusha 2, sold really well in Japan, sold fairly well in North America, sold abysmally, like it sold the weakest in Europe compared to all the other territories. And that alone, when Capcom got that sales data back, was reason enough for them to like think of a way to get European players interested again. So they decided to cast a European actor. That's it. Makes enough sense.
Tell me the name of that woman.
Oyu.
Oyu.
Are you sure?
Why? Do you know something about her?
I think I've seen her somewhere. Anyway, don't trust her. Believe me, Jubei. Don't turn your back on her.
Remember, Jubei. Bros before hoes.
Kotaro.
All right. Here we are. We're back in town. Look at our beautiful, shiny metal steed. We're gonna save back at the inn and get ready to finish up our final visit to Imasho. Because we're not coming back here, essentially. A steed that no one bats an eye at. Apparently, yeah. Weird how that works out. Though demons are an everyday occurrence, too. That is correct. Everyone is just in pants-shitting terror of these things every single day. You probably look at, like, a metal, like, reanimated magic horse, and it's like, this is just Tuesday. Alright, so. Actually want to get something figured out quickly. Right, okay, so now that we're back in Imasho Town, that also means we can get an important item that we were promised for doing the watermelon quest. It was you who gave me that melon. Yep. We got the orange necklace. What is the orange necklace, you might add? Well, put simply, it allows us to find and absorb hidden red souls. There are hidden red soul clusters all throughout the entire game. So let's go and get some of those clusters while also grinding a shit ton of money. Because right now what we need is 9600, I believe it is. And we're like just the tiniest bit less than a quarter there. But it's alright. We got a bunch of tech moves for our sword. We got ways to make money and orbs fast. So. Nice. Oh, triple combo. Actually, let me get this money first. Excellent. Yeah, I am glad that these are the enemies that spawn now. This is so much easier to deal with. Aside from slightly different attacks. Alright, then the first soul cluster we can get to should be up in this particular... Yep, you can see it. You see that glowing purple spot? Alas, the clusters themselves are not... they don't hold a lot of souls compared to, like, the clearly visible ones, you know? Ah, there it is. And you also got to be very close. Although, oh wow, that's actually a pretty... Okay, that's a sizably larger cluster than the other one was. Let's get Brighto to level 3. Okay, so that's number 2. Gotta figure out what the storage exit is. Northwest. Or northeast, I forget. Hold on. There should just be like 2 more clusters that we can find in this entire mine. So we're gonna do that while also getting more money and souls along the way. Yeah, this is good. God. Ugh. And I can only imagine just like how intense it must be for people that are able to do like perfect run-throughs of this game and just how much they have to commit to memory to have like the optimal playthrough. Because doing things optimally to get like the S or perfect rank for it is like somewhere around like 5 hours, I'm pretty sure. And that's like skipping cutscenes for sure. Okay, that's another. That's now we just gotta go to the north. Nice. Yeah, I have no idea what possibly the Isen timing could be for that, but I don't care. Level 2 charge attack gets the job done. That's pretty good. Oh god, it's another one of those. Oh shit. Ah, shit. Come on. Got it! A lot of health, a lot of orbs. 180 and 100. Okay. Shit. Ah. Oh, I missed my timing! Crap, come on. Oh, are you kidding? You know, fuck it. We'll just do this. Okay, so now it makes more sense. Like, that follow-up on, like, the upward slash is what you do to deal with, like, these bigger enemies that don't get easily launched. That makes more sense. Yo, nice. Excellent timing on that, my dude. Any more, please? Yeah, just keep them coming. Keep them coming. How many more can we get? 4, 5? Oh, that's a lot. And that's 3,900. Not bad, not bad. Okay. Oh, all right, I see you, I see you. Ah, Ah, you were hiding up there, I see. Little bastard. Any more? Ah! Ooh, that's a big bonus. Very nice. Yep, this is the grind. Not really much else to really say on this, but, I mean, that's to be expected. I'm having fun, though. Alright. I think that's it. Cool. Alright, let's head to the northern part of the mine. That should be where the final cluster is. Ah! Yeah, just stop trying to go for those, Yeah, I just gotta give up. Oh god, I almost had a sneeze coming. I feel like I just gotta give up on trying to get E-Sense off of those big dudes. It is so much more practical and still gives me a decent amount of orbs if I just do, like, level 2 charge into, like, Fiend Stealer. Which, that's probably not, like, the actual name. I just call it that because that's what the name of, like, the specific move is in Ninja Gaiden. Nice. I didn't even see that attack coming, but I still got the critical. That was awesome. Holy shit. Oh, yeah. Oh my god, we got literal freaking robots now. You know, why not? Oh, oh god. Oh, fuck. Yeah, but I want to kill these dudes because, like, that would drop 300. That's got to be something. Yeah. Okay, I got to switch over to spear. We'll try this. Oh, wow. Yeah, another 300. It... Oh god, it just straight up... Wow, it freezes and then you just blow them up. I was not prepared for that. That's amazing. Wow, okay. I completely forgot those even were enemies you could come across. And they otherwise just seem to ignore you unless you attack. So really, I am... I'm the one who's the asshole in this case. There it is. There's that soul cluster. Jeez, and I got a lot saved up. Okay. That's good. And the way to Gifu Castle is sealed back up again, so it's whatever. Oh, wait. They seem to remember me. Oh, no. Let's see. This should put me at level max. Yes, it did. Excellent. And I will start working on getting my armor up to level 3. And eventually get back around to the spear. Oh god, I didn't even think to save there back then. Could you have imagined if I had died on that first encounter with the... Oh wow. That would have been bad. Okay, so... Oh yeah, I am close. I am close to 9600. Let's get back to it. Oh crap. No. I wanted to get some space. My brain works in weird ways. You say excellent, my brain automatically overlays Aku with Samurai Jack. Wow, okay. Yeah, that's an interesting association, I gotta say. Yeah, it's like, they just seem to drop 150 on average, these big guys. And that just seemed to kill him in one hit. I'm surprised. Alright, but let's get some orbs back, especially health. Whoa. There we go. Can we get some more spawned in here? Oh my god. Please just... Oh, I missed my chance! You fucker. Are you kidding? How did that not... Wow, they are really... They're suddenly making it very difficult for me to actually get Isen on them. Okay, that time it started working again. Yeah, that was a bit obnoxious. Actually, now that I'm starting to get back some of my magic, I could probably go back to that room with the robots and, like, kill them one last time. Especially if they keep dropping 300 gold apiece. That's a lot.
Yeah.
All right. Oh my god, just the bad timing. And of course I couldn't see. That complicated things. Oh, Isen the jump attack. That was dope. Oh, he was still in the middle of his spawn animation, so he did not get hit by it. Oh, well, fair enough, game, fair enough. How much money do I have? 89, okay. Actually, you know, with, like, how much... It's probably a lot faster if I just keep farming this spot instead of going back to where the robots are. Wow, just sent that dude flying. Alright. We're almost done, though. I think this hallway one last time. And then some of the big guys. Unless they... Okay, no, they do spawn. The timing was weird. Only three? Fine. I'll take that. 50, 60. Definitely dropping quite a bit. Okay, there's two. Can I get a third? No, guess not. Ah, come on. You asshole. Sometimes my timing just fails me for no reason, and then stuff like this happens. Ah! Asshole! There we go. How much is that? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, we can start making our way back to town. I think we're good. We'll have enough money to buy out all the remaining items. Oh, actually, I think I'll stop by here first, see if that big dude spawns again. Yeah, he did. $150 gold. Thank you. Okay. Are those big guys gonna spawn again or not? God. Finally. Oh, wow. At this point, I think just like... Yeah, it's like my sword is now at like its maximum power that like the follow-up on that upper slash just no longer... Ah. Okay, that's pretty good. We're back to 4 purple orbs. Just hold on to that. Don't pop Onimusha mode until you absolutely need it. Very good. A free 10 gold. Very nice. 95-10, yeah. We can absolutely get our remaining gold when we're on the hill back to the village. And let's also just get arm armor back. As close to level 3, which I assume is the maximum. Yeah, we're doing pretty good as far as, like, getting these resources as early as we can. Okay, I think that's 4. How much more can we get? Alright, let's get a few more bunched up, if possible. Oh, I see one coming up as we speak. Ooh, quad kill! Any more? Ah, crap. Oh, triple kill. That was kind of a weird angle on that second hit, but whatever. It hit an enemy both behind and in front of me, so I'll take it. Fuck it. Okay. How much money we got? 9990. Just 10 short of, like, 10,000, but it's whatever. I'll take it. Let's head inside. Stop by the mirror. Enchant our arm guards. Yep. There we go. And now they're at max. Ooh. Wow, I've been going at this. Recorded time is like 2 hours 58 minutes, but obviously I've done a few resets. Otherwise, this makes sense for like what has basically been about 3 hours, I think. 3 hours plus. Oh, hey! Thinking of closing the store and returning to my hometown. I'll give you a special discount. Please buy a lot. Gladly. I will buy everything. Your black pill, your pocket watch, your Pandora's box, calligraphy kit, history book volume number 8, which I believe is the one history book that Kotaro actually likes, so we're giving him everything. Frangie for Oyu. Oh yeah, also we gotta make sure that we give these new weapons to each of the characters as well, so they'll do better. Green Parrot. A pair ring. It is said that two persons who have these rings will be united by strong ties. Excellent! Nothing left, so I can happily return to my hometown. Oh, but he's got one more. It's a white necklace. I'll miss you. Same. White necklace. This restores your vitality gradually if you stand still. That's... will be helpful in the moments when I don't feel like just using, like, any healing items. Because I've definitely used a couple more than I would have liked. But it's fine. It's fine. Yeah. Now let's save again. because it's, I just want to make sure that I don't screw up anything accidentally when doing another set of trades with Kotaro. Wait, no, I forgot, he's upstairs, shit. Turn around. Oh wait, hold on, there is... That's right, fuck, I think there's something I could still do up in the marketplace area that get like a specific item. I gotta find a man who's just walking around like he's drunk. See an iron horse. It's a shame you miss an opportunity like this. Well, it's right over there, buddy. Have you ever heard of an iron horse? Okay, yeah. I guess to elaborate on what you mentioned earlier, Arian. Yeah, they do recognize that there's a metal horse in the steeds and are going like, do you see this shit? Okay, here he is. Just keep talking with this dude. This is for you. Study hard. The Taizo Mandala. Excellent. You only get this item when the drunk is in the marketplace. Talk to any of the sub-characters first. You'll trigger an event that forces this man to the main street. Well, fortunately, I got him right now. They care. It's neat attention to detail. 100%. Now, okay, there should be a man with a backpack who will give us a glass. Is he around here? Yes. There he is. Can I buy this horse? I'll give my fortune to have it. Yeah, everyone is enamored with our fucking iron horse. That is amazing. I love this game. Like, in my head, I am now going back to, like, questioning what I actually like as my favorite Onimusha. Because for the past few years, it definitely had been Genma. But this is starting to rekindle those thoughts of, no, maybe this is actually my favorite. Buy a bottle of Black Bear from the bartender. Oh, good. I have just enough, actually. Okay. Oh, wait. There are still a couple of items I could have gotten at the mine itself. Apparently, that same dude I think that gave us dice the first time can give us loaded dice. Alright, fine, fuck it, I'm running back up. Okay. Coming through. Alright. And once that's done, we can finally start doing some item trading. Get our side characters properly equipped. While giving the rest of our hard-earned gifts to Kotaro. Because he is the best character and deserves it. Oh no, I don't want those. I don't want that purple orb yet. Not yet. Ugh. Now I'll deal with those later. Right now, I just need the items first and foremost. Fortunately, like, the NPCs that we can get items from are, like, near the beginning. Most people have already left. Yada yada. Good that there is gold, but it's a shame there's so many monsters. I agree. It's almost like it's not worth staying around in this shithole. Don't tell anyone I gave you this. They're loaded. Gee, I wonder why. Alright, there should be, an NPC here that can, like, give us, like, some medicine. Not much gold, but I guess it's time to give up. Thanks for the medicine. stock up on as many health items as we can. Now we can go back to town and start trading. Okay. Back down we go. Get some more enemies to spawn as well. Can't help myself with, like, killing this many goons. Ah, crap. Oh, nice, Blocky-sen. That was fucking tight. Any more besides you? I guess not. All right. That was fun. So yeah, we're definitely coming up, I think, on the amount of time I'm willing to keep playing for. So once everything is done here in Imasho Town and we move on to the next area, I will save and call it quits for today and resume with, like, some, you know, continuing to play this game, but for, like, shorter streams. Oh, hey, look at the balcony. Oh, he's right up there. All right. Time to save again for safety's sake. Give the new weapons and or armor to our compatriots. Oh yeah. God, this has been fun going back through this. All right. So we need to give a Maguichi specific item. Yeah, the Kurai Shinki. You can shoot 5 needle bullets at a time with this powerful weapon. It's a quintuple barrel rifle. Like, I get, like, early weapon concepts and history were pretty nutty before things got standardized, but come on. Unusually pleased, he says. There we go. We got the second, like, we got the final charge attack tech for our staff.
I guess I was wrong about you. Seems you're pretty popular with the ladies. One wearing armor is waiting for you on the second floor of this bar.
Oh, thanks.
Another one is waiting in the marketplace. Choose wisely. You don't have time for both.
Yeah, so that's the trigger for, like, there's, like, another NPC we gotta talk to eventually that leads us to the next part of the game. Anyway, Eke... Where is it? Hotengeki, this spear has 2 crescent-shaped blades at its head. Yeah, see, that makes sense.
This will suit me very well.
Yeah, I'm sure it will. A hearty big laugh. Dokutsui Tech. We haven't even gotten that weapon yet, but we will eventually. And once we do, we'll be prepped and ready to go on that. Anyway, let's dump as many of our gifts as we can on Kotaro. The Gabishi, iron stilettos with rings for fingers to handle. Interesting weapon.
Can I test this on you?
Just kidding.
Yeah. Spirit is very high. Senpumaru tech. Right, yeah, because we got like a fourth weapon that we get later on. So we now got like second level charge moves for those weapons as soon as we get them. But now we need to keep giving more. So, okay, what do we got? So... Black Pill. Okay, that's a B rank. We'll do that. Keep getting more and more items that we can out of this dude.
This is nice.
It is nice. Smiles with pleasure. More fire arrows. Saying that you can even unlock this stuff so early. I know! It's great! But like, that's the sort of thing where it's like, yeah, if you're doing a first playthrough blind, naturally, a whole lot of stuff is just gonna fly over your head, you know? But that's what makes, like, the subsequent playthrough so much more interesting. Especially with, like, this game's scenario map. Anyway, let's see. This confetti. Yeah, confetti is a B. We'll do that.
It's good for quick energy.
Well, yeah, it's candy. A fossilized bone. I forget who that goes to, potentially. Yeah. Oh, yeah, crystal ball. I'm sure he'd be amused by simple fortune-telling items.
It's rare. Thank you.
No problem. Dumpling cake. Yeah, we got some dongo. Excellent. Yeah, fork. Frog, fur skin. Glass has no value. Oh, but he likes the green parrot. Here you go, more bird friends.
You are beautiful.
I am a man, you feathered scum.
Wow. Okay. I'm not sure if that was actually supposed to be the correct response. He shrugged his shoulders, but I think that means something. I don't know. Or maybe just like the letter grade on it got incorrectly associated on the walkthrough. I'm not sure. Whatever. So, history books. There is one history book that he absolutely likes, and that's Volume 8. The volume that talks about valiant warriors. Hopefully the walkthrough's correct on that.
I can get into this.
Yeah, he can. All right. He's excited and satisfied. So we got normal bullets. Now then, I think... Wait, did I pick up some incense? I did. Somehow that also counts as something that he really likes. So we'll try that. Weirdly enough, the loaded dies, they have a negative effect on him.
My friends will be jealous.
All right. So, let's see. Oh. Okay, hold on. Okay, this is important. I'm looking at the guide again. Again, further nuance of this insane gift-giving system. Like, a novel depicting men and women relationships, it reveals the bare facts. It's clearly, like, a smut. If I were to have given this to him early on, it would have been rank F. But at 500 alliance points, it gets, like, an A rank. And a para ring, meanwhile, gives me, like... It's an A rank, but it's worth like 200 plus points. So I am going to, once I've given everything else, I think I can give Kotaro, I am going to save come back, give him the naughty novel, and then see if that gets me a better reward as well. Because otherwise, yeah, I can give him Paris Ring and Pandora's Box.
Come on now, you're embarrassing me.
Hey man, we're bros. Big smile shows his approval. Excellent. They just got so much that we gotta give right now. Nobody knows what is inside of this mysterious object.
Awesome!
Oh yeah, he digs it. Overwhelmed with surprise. Something must have been nice inside that box. Okay. So... oh yeah, we could give the pocket watch now. Which I forget if that could be combined with something. I don't think it can. I'm just double checking. Oh wait, oh god damn it, I'm an idiot. I just realized because I was looking at Red Parrot. And I noticed that the reaction when I gave him the Green Parrot seemed off. That's because when it comes to the parrots, they say different things. What things they say is determined by what point in the game you're at. So because I had finished... what was it? I gave him the Green Parrot. Yeah, I gave him the Green Parrot. And because I gave it to him after returning to Imasho Town after going through Gifu Castle, instead of an A rank, that was a D rank. Like, what? But meanwhile, the Red Parrot, if I give it to him now, because it's after the gold mine even, that should be an A rank. We'll see.
You are cute!
Stop that, I'm not a baby.
Or maybe it was like, once I'm specifically... okay, no, never mind. I guess either some parts of the guides are wrong, or I needed to do it at an even earlier time. Okay. Yeah, this is... oh, the complexity. I swear to fucking Christ. This is so dumb. But yeah, let's give him the pocket watch just to make up for things.
Wow. Is this what they call a pocket watch?
Yep. Okay, is there anything else? Jeez, I got 5 Wonder Flowers. Let's see. I think that's it, actually. Okay, so I'll save one last time, go back to him, give him the naughty novel, and see how that goes. This gift-giving system is just one of the most insane shit ever. It is baffling, yet I love it all the same. Even if it is clearly made with the idea of trying to sell you on the strategy guide back in the day. Because how else would you have been able to parse all this? Alright. Well, kid, I'm pretty sure you're old enough for this to work. No, we're not giving the love potion, which has a different reaction if we are high enough in, like, alliance points or affection. But I don't think we're even close to that because it requires, like, I think 800? It's ridiculous. Let's see how you'd like it.
I don't want this. Well, maybe.
Yeah, you do. You're a man. Overwhelmed with surprise. Yeah, it is. Okay, that was good. Let's give some gifts to Oya. Let's give her her armor and weapon. Oh god, that's right, the flowers. Like, if you don't give them to someone, they wilt and they become dead. Oh, that's right. Oh shit. Everything passes with age. Oh, it would have been fucking funny to just try and give it to her as is. Alright, Ferengi, here you go.
This sword will do nicely.
What a game. What a game. And a power jewel. And let's give her the armor.
This fits great.
Yeah, it does. And medicine. Yeah, we'll use that. Fossilized bone, an artificial stone that was made on the model of a rib. This might be inserted somewhere. So it wasn't even a gift. But it was still important to get it anyway. That's weird. All right, then. I think we got everything. My relation with Kotaro is as strong as can be, even with some gift-giving mishaps. But I gave him definitely more than 8 items, and I'm pretty sure all of them were favorable at some point. So, it's time to leave this place. Oh, who's this?
Look at me. Do you like what you see?
Oh, Jesus. Kill it with fire.
Lord Nobunaga is worthy of my life. My body and my mind belong to him. No one shall stand in the Lord's way. Jubei, you and that hateful woman, Takajo, must die! Ha!
Oh, damn. Oh, my back.
Here we go. I'll go to Yagyu Village and kill her. The chase is on!
Well, shit, time to go back home. Yagyu Village, open space. All right. That has been a lengthy as hell first session for this game. Actually, hold on. Since I'm standing here, I might as well show off the white necklace in action before we save. Is it going up? Yes, it is. Very, very slowly. Oh, no, it's going faster. Okay. Jeez, how long are we alive for? 3 hours. Well, coming up on 3 hours and 50 minutes. Wow. This time sure flew by going through this game. But this was... Yeah, this was a blast, to say the least. Like, what a game. Onimusha 2 is a great game. Like, I still got, like, some lingering bias towards, like, the structure and style of Onimusha 1, especially with Genma, since it also includes the Onimusha mode and charge attacks that this game has, plus some other additions that are exclusive to it, but cannot emphasize enough, this game is an adventure. The whole thing is just you being on one giant epic journey across Japan to eventually kill Nobunaga. And that journey is going to continue. And, like, future segments of this stream, I'm pretty sure are going to go a lot faster now that we are no longer in a position where we need to grind for money. Because we're not going back to Imasho. We bought out the inventory from the store all three times. So that's... Everything is going to be, I'm pretty sure, a lot more straightforward. Not to mention, next time we play, with how everything has gone with the gift giving, we are guaranteed, I'm pretty sure, like a playable side mission as Kotaro. So look forward to that. Next stream for this is just going to be Monday morning, and hopefully it'll be evening streams from here on out. Why is Nobunaga a demon in most games anyway? It's taking a complicated historical character and just brute force reducing him into like a generic Satan figure. Largely because, yes, he was an important figure in Sengoku-era Japan, whose exploits I'm pretty sure would qualify for all manners of heinous war crimes, even compared to other figures in that time period. But also, I'm pretty sure parts of it are just some of his stuff was things that, like, certain, I guess, like, people that value Japan's, like, traditional values and things like that would probably have extra reason to think he was the most awful person because he actively went against like Buddhism as being like the country, like the state religion, and also openly embraced the use of firearms in warfare. Never mind the fact that he was the first one to come across with the idea of like, no, I'm going to actually try and unify this country, and got most of the way there before dying. At which point, Hideyoshi started to try and continue that, and then Ieyasu basically finished the job and brought in the Edo period. That's like the very rough summarization of events, as far as I remember it. Basically, don't expect Japanese media to show like an accurate portrayal of who Nobunaga was, unless you're Koei Tecmo. Because Koshi Misawa is just the biggest Nobunaga fanboy still living in Japan, I'm pretty sure. Oh well. We'll deal with Nobunaga in the future. In the meantime, thanks again everyone that stopped by to watch me play through the starting hours of this game. Like, this is still... Oh god. These games are special. They're definitely games I think about that are like another great representation of why like the PS2 generation was just some of, if not like the best time for games, period. Like on PS2, Xbox, PC, around this time, even GameCube. It was all such a good time. I love it. Alright. I gotta eat. I gotta cool off and like air out my room, obviously, because it's been like 4 hours of just keeping this place airtight. So, yeah. See you all on Monday, where I'll continue the stream. Take care. Later.